conditions team. I'll talk about that as we move on. Feel free to interrupt, but longer discussions towards the end are better because I've designed the talk in such a way that there's a lot of time for discussion. So if there's something, there's a topic you want to get into too much detail, we can move towards it. So let's start with our usual protagonists, Alice and Bob. So this is Alice. Alice is happily browsing the internet. But one day she knows that, or comes to discover that the government is spying on her. The government is engaging in surveillance, right? And then we have Bob. Bob is also happily browsing the internet. But one day Bob discovers that his favorite website has been censored. Now in Canada, that's not a problem, but I can tell you that's a problem in many, many countries. What Alice and Bob would actually like is to be anonymous on the internet and to browse the internet without the fear of surveillance. So basically, they want to be completely anonymous. That's what they desire. This is this very famous column by Peter Steiner in 1993. It says, on the internet, nobody knows you are a cock. But this is from 1993. Things have changed. But now, they know what type of a dog you are. Right? They know everything about you. So what's the solution to this problem? And I've given this talk in different countries and the context always differs. Like in Canada, I haven't heard of any censorship. Has anyone heard of censorship in Canada? Online censorship? Do you know any instance?
Oh, weird things that we had to censor.
Hate speech probably, stuff like that, I guess?
Strangely enough, it wasn't bad. It was political things from certain countries that basically were causing problems in Canada.
Okay.
This was when I was at Primus 10 years ago. But isn't the key one censored everywhere?
This would be a great discussion for after.
I'm pretty sure people have this discussion in mind. So one way you can protect yourself is using something called Tor, which stands for the Onion Router. Originally, this started as a U.S. Naval research project. And what they were trying to do is to come up with something that was decentralized and could be used by anyone. And that's why Tor is like free and open source. You can download it, you can study the source code. It's completely free of cost. So let's see how it works. So suppose Alice wants to access a website. The destination here can be anything. It can be a web server, it can be an email server, it can be a chat server. So how Tor works is that people all over the world run something called Tor relays. Okay, so it's volunteer driven. So there are like 6,000 relays as we speak. So out of those 6,000 relays, you pick 3 at random. Now, of course, there's more mathematics to the randomness here. But easy understanding, let's say you pick 3 at random. And then these 3 nodes are, as we call them, first is the entry guard, the middle one is the middle relay, and the last one is the exit relay. So what then happens is that you build something called a circuit to these 3 relays. And if you see, the exit relay will be the one that is actually fetching the content for you. So the first relay knows your source. It knows your IP address, because if you connect to it, it will of course know your IP address, right? But the first relay doesn't know what destination you're trying to reach. It doesn't know the address of the website you're trying to access. But the last relay knows what destination you're trying to access, because if it doesn't know, then it can't get the page for you, right? But it doesn't know who you are. Now the question is, why do we have 3 relays and not 2? Because this could be achieved using 2 relays as well, right? I mean, if you have 2 relays, you could get the same thing. But the problem with that is that there's something called a timing attack. So if an adversary, say NSA, CSIS, or something like that, they are watching the first and the last node, it's very easy to figure out who you are on Tor, and this is the only way to break Tor. So this is called a timing attack. If the adversary is watching the first node and the last node, you're de-anonymized. Okay. So that's why there are 3. One middle node serves as an extra, relay just to prevent this timing attack.
Is it always 3, or did
you
vary?
You can change it, but that doesn't give you anything extra because you still suffer from the same problem. Let's suppose we make it 4, but in that case as well, if the adversary is watching the first and the last, same problem. So making the chain longer doesn't give you anything else. Doesn't give you extra anonymity benefits. Can you do it? Yes, you can. Do they recommend that you do it? No. Okay. So this is the basic architecture. Relays are run by volunteers. There are many universities running relays. There's this many rumors going on. The NSA runs many relays. The FBI runs relays. We don't know. It could be possible that they're doing it. But that's why one of the things that we're trying to do is to get relays run by people we know in real life, like universities, libraries, because we can trust them as compared to random people. So do intelligence agencies run relays? I don't know. There's not been any study, and if even they were, I don't think we could find out. So what are the design goals? First, it's a low latency anonymity system. So that means you can do stuff in real time. Like, so if you fetch a web page, you can see it immediately instead of waiting for it. This is different from anonymized systems in the past, in which, so some anonymization systems used to do that if you send them an email, they'll fetch the page for you. So you have to actually wait just to get the page back. But Tor is low latency, so you can do stuff like chat, XMPP, and stuff over Tor. Distributed design, there's no single server that's controlling everything, it's completely distributed. Right now, we have like more than 2 million users as of now. I got these numbers today. If you want to see those numbers, it's on metrics.org. There are about 6,000 relays. The total available bandwidth in the network is 100 gigabits per second. This is very, very different from when I started using Tor, which was in 2008. The network has gone a lot better now, and it's a lot faster. At that time, I remember it was impossible to even fetch a web page because it was so slow. But now, sometimes it's difficult for me to tell the difference between my Tor connection and normal internet even. So who uses Tor is the question I've been asked a lot. So number one, journalists. Journalists use Tor to get in touch with the sources without anyone finding out. There's something called SecureDrop. Has anyone heard of that?
Yeah.
So talk about SecureDrop. Many Canadian newspapers also run it. The Globe and Mail runs it. The CBC runs it. The New York Times runs it in the US, among many other organizations. So what this gives you, and I'll talk about in detail, is that journalists can talk to their sources without anyone finding out. Activists use Tor. I have personally met many activists who use Tor in countries where the internet is censored. And there are many countries where the internet is heavily censored, like active censorship. And everyday people use Tor, like I use Tor, and I've met people who use Tor, and they tell me that they want to visit a website, but they didn't want their ISP finding out about it. Not even bad stuff, but general stuff that they don't want. This. So I've met people who do health research on Tor because they don't want their ISP even finding out that they're researching something online. I get one question is, do bad people use Tor? Yes, they do. We didn't design it for them, but as a side effect of any technology.
Bad people use the internet as well.
Sorry?
Bad people use the internet as well.
Bad people use the internet, bad people use cell phones, so. Let's look at the difference between a VPN and Tor, okay? Let's look at why would we want to use a VPN or why would we want to use Tor. So if you're talking about invading censorship, Tor and Tor browser are different things, as I'll explain this in the next slide, but for now you can consider them to be one thing. So if you're talking about, if you're a country where there's censorship, would you use a VPN or would you use Tor? Now VPN gets 2 and Tor gets 3 because it's very easy to block access to a VPN because you can just block the domain or you can block the IP addresses. But it's a lot difficult to block access to the Tor network as such. We'll talk about that as well.
One other thing with VPN, you can just block VPN protocols.
Right.
So
you could block VPN protocols.
Yeah.
Right. That's a very good point.
Yeah.
I should remember that to put in the slides and up there. Yeah. Right. Appear elsewhere. The VPN is probably easier because you could choose to exit in a different country. So you could connect to a VPN server somewhere in, say, Europe, for example. With Tor, you could do that. You can choose your exit, but it's a bit difficult. I mean, and if there's no one running an exit really in that country, you can appear elsewhere in that country, right? With a VPN service, if you want to exit to Europe, you can say, I want to pick the server in Germany, and you can have a German IP address, right? Anonymity with a VPN, you're basically trusting the VPN company to not log anything. And most VPN providers say they don't log anything, but you never know if they do or they do not. They say that, and you have to trust them, basically. But with Tor and Tor browser, there's no concept of logging as such because it's decentralized. And if the question is, can relay operators log? Yes, but we try very hard to detect that and try to convince them to not do that. Privacy VPN again suffers from the same problem, that they tell you that they don't log, but you never know. And if you read the news today, I don't think I'm supposed to name the company, but it was in the news in the evening that a very famous VPN provider was basically logging everything. So if you just Google privacy VPN today, and you find the name of the company. You know. But with Tor and Tor browser, there's no logging, so.
For one thing I would like to say, the VPN providers, a lot of them don't actually know they're logging.
That's true as well.
Yeah.
They may not be.
A lot of hardware comes predefined logged. Right. For logging, and you have to go in and actually turn that on.
That's true.
And almost no one does.
Right. That's a good point. Because you're basically trusting the VPN with their security setup and stuff, so you never know how good or bad it is. Speed, of course, if you want to watch Netflix, but you no longer can do that, you would get a VPN, or you wouldn't do that over Torrent, or is still slower compared to a VPN. But as far as cost is concerned, you pay for a good VPN, but Tor is completely free and will always be free, and it's open source as well. So there are many more things, but I think this was the main stuff I wanted to get in the presentation. How do you decide what to use? If you want to stream movies, get a VPN. If you want to do general surfing or you want to protect your anonymity, I would recommend Tor. So most of Tor is a C program that's called little ttor. It's a C program that does everything. So you have one, so it's, if you see the slides here, the same program runs on the client, and the same program runs on the relay. So there's just one program, okay? It runs as a daemon and sets up a local SOX 5 proxy. So when you install Tor, it sets up a SOX 5 proxy, and if your application needs to use Tor, then you can just point it towards the proxy address, which in most cases is 127.0.0.1 and 90.5.0.4. Right? So when Tor sets up, it creates a proxy on this address. And if you want your software to use Tor, then you would just point it to use the proxy. It runs on Linux, Mac OS, Windows, and all BSD variants. So all platforms are supported. And again, it's the same program, so you'll take the same binary and run. If you want to run a client, that runs as a client. If you want to run it a relay, it runs as a relay. I wanted to give a demo. So you just you download, so the website address is of course torproject.org. You download the archive and then just extract it. And then you, so if you run it with the verbose slide, it will show you everything, the output, it redirects the output standard out. If you don't do that, that's also fine. So normally in Canada and countries where there is no censorship, we will just do connect. Okay, but in countries where the internet is censored, and I'll talk about that, they try very actively to block Tor, so normal connection doesn't work and you have to use other stuff that's built in. But let's go with the normal one for now. So what's it doing right now is that it's fetching all those relays, it's downloading them, and then it will create a circuit. It doesn't create just one circuit, it creates many, but I don't want to get into technical stuff right now. Okay, so now Tor is running. So this is Tor browser. So basically Tor browser is a very heavily modified version of Firefox with a lot of security patches. This is what you should be using. So this is Firefox modified plus Tor the daemon and a bunch of other stuff we'll talk about. Okay. So if you have to use Tor, don't just install the daemon and start Firefox and point it towards Tor. That's the wrong way of thinking. The right way is that you download Tor browser and then just run that. So let's open something. So if you click here, it will show you the three readers. The first reader is in Switzerland, the second is in the United States, and the third is in the United States as well. So basically, the website sees that, the website thinks that you are in the US and not in Canada. Okay? So, but I want to change this, and then if you do a new door circuit for this website, you get a different. You can change it as many times as you want. Okay, so can you pick where you exit? Yes, you could. Say I want to always exit in Canada, you can specify that. Well, that's a bit advanced, so.
What would be the advantage?
The advantage is that the website doesn't know where you're connecting from.
No, I mean the exiting or the choice. I mean.
Some websites actually check your IP address. So if you try to open it from somewhere, say other than Canada, for example, they don't allow you to open that.
Well, there's also websites specifically in the US that if you're not a US, you can't actually.
Right. That's right.
You see their
content.
So, yeah, their content. So basically, in that case, you would want to exit in the US.
Right.
Yeah. Can you exclude countries?
You can. You could exclude countries as well. So you could choose that I don't want to exit in this particular country. Okay. So every tab is basically. So if we open.
Is it wise to check each time?
No, I mean, you don't have to check each time.
No, that's where you're exiting.
I don't think it would change unless you specifically asked it to change.
It changes. Everything fades in and out. If you notice this, this is. That was exiting in France and this is in the United States. Every tab is basically a new circuit. So every tab you open, the websites, they can't correlate who you are, basically.
Are cookies shared between tabs?
I think not.
Okay.
Yeah, they're not. I think there's very good per tab isolation.
Cool.
So this is basically our browser, and it has a bunch of other stuff to talk about. There's also something called the security slider. So it depends on basically how paranoid you are. I know people who run it at very high. So let's see what basically they do. Medium disables JavaScript and stuff. HTML5 video become like you have to click to play the videos, which is actually a good thing if you think about it, right? And in very high settings, everything is like I've tried this and most websites just don't render properly. So. But depends on how paranoid you are, right? I mean, I know people who run it on always high, I know people who run it on low, depends on what you're trying to do. I've seen many websites fail at medium even, so just telling you in case that shit doesn't work for you.
You just try to run with no script, you spend most of the time open.
That's true, it messes up the entire UI.
How do CDNs work? Because obviously they serve from the closest relay to their system, right?
Right, right.
So would you constantly always get the closest relay to your exit node?
You would. I mean, there's no difference in that. Yeah.
How about DNS going
to
the proxy?
The DNS goes to the proxy, so it's actually remote DNS. So if you're trying to use Tor, your ISP finds out nothing about any website you're trying to visit because the DNS is remote. So in this case, the DNS is actually resolved by the exit node. So this relay will actually resolve the DNS, and not you locally.
Is the Tor exit node relying on host operating system's DNS?
Right.
It
is. Yeah.
So.
Not sure.
Sorry. Do you mean host of the exit or host of the client?
Host of the exit.
Yes. Yes.
So you're trusting that the exit node is playing fair with DNS?
Yes. You are trusting that. And you're trusting many other things as well, and we'll talk about that.
Is there a DNS actually run within the Tor network?
Sorry?
But you could have alternative DNS servers. So is there one actually run within the Tor network? They basically take a full copy of the root DNSs.
I don't think
they do that. Which isn't that big anymore.
Right. I don't think they do that. No. It's basically relying on the exit of the DNS of the exit.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is a very interesting question. So basically, if you send anything in plain clear text, like HTTP, for example, the exit node can of course sniff on your connection and find out what you're trying to do. That's a given anyway, right? So one way of mitigating that is that there's something called HTTPS everywhere. So what HTTPS everywhere does is, how many have heard about it? Great. So HTTPS everywhere, what it does is, I'll talk about it, is that it redirects from HTTP to HTTPS wherever it can. So if someone's trying to do bad stuff with your connection, then it throw up an error because you can't just intercept SSL. Okay. So one of the important things is that at this part, let's suppose you're sending your username and password over HTTP. It's entirely possible that this exit relay may sniff that and do something with it. But if you're using HTTPS, of course, that problem goes away. Not completely. There have been many attacks. So what happens is, if someone detects that there's tampering going on, they report it to us, and then we blacklist the relay from the system. So we call this the bad relays. So if you figure out some relays tampering with the connection, you will email us and we'll blacklist it. So one of it is not 100% foolproof, but we'll try to get close to it, I guess. So this is our browser. You can try it out. I've left my email address. I'll show you at the end of the slide in case you have any questions. Runs on all three platforms. Again, just use Tor browser, do not use Tor and Firefox or Safari or Google Chrome or anything like that. Okay.
For the Tor browser, right. Is it the Firefox ESR release or is
that's
it
the Firefox ESR.
ESR.
So Tor browser is built on top of Firefox ESR with a lot of security patches. Like I said, it's open source. Go on the website, see all the code and see all the patches they're putting in. Everything we do is in the open. All discussions are open, all development is open. There's an IRC channel, and I'll point you towards that in case you're interested.
What's the user base so that the feedback for any problems might occur? How do you tell, in other words? Because you say that if you report back on some exit, if your user base is really small, then
that's true. The bad readers thing, they actually check if the relay is actively trying to tamper with the connection. And so suppose if you report it and I check it at that time, I'm not the one who does it though. Yeah. And if someone checks it at that time and it actually is tampering or they have good evidence of tampering, they usually go ahead and block it. Yeah. But since it's a volunteer run system, there's no way to be 100% sure, right?
Sounds like it's their notion of something like Tor browser, a privacy, something that's privacy oriented. Is that something that you guys have any interaction with?
There's a lot of interaction between Tor and Firefox because people who work on Tor browser try to get all the patches upstream. They try to get as many patches as they can through Firefox. But I don't think I can give you a good answer on the question you just asked.
Okay.
Yeah. But there's a lot of interaction for sure, because we rely heavily on Firefox. So without Firefox, Tor browser couldn't exist. So let's talk about onion services, or as they were called before, hidden services. This is the part of Tor that gets the most press. So who here has heard of Silkroom? The dark web. So this is basically what it was. So they used to call it hidden services. But now they call it onion services because it's getting an upgrade. So this is the part of Tor that gets the most press because a lot of bad websites, for whatever word, how the word that is defined, are hosted on something called onion services. And let's see what they are. So if you try to access these .onion websites as a normal user, they doesn't work for you. Okay. So what you need is Tor. So the only way you could open these specific websites is using Tor or Tor browser, to be more specific. So if you have Tor browser installed, I'll give you an example. These websites will open for you. If not, they don't open for you. The benefit of this is that anything that's hosted as an Onion service, and it can be a web server, it can be a mail server, it can be a chat server, and the client, the connection is end-to-end encrypted, okay, by default, so you don't have to worry about sending anything in plain text. The other benefit is that, so let's suppose you're running a mail server and you don't want to find anyone to find out where you are. That's how all those websites run behind an Onion service, and there's no way to censor them because I don't think, like, this is not me speaking for Tor, but I don't think we would be able to position that we would take down a page because we don't want to be the ones that are making that decision. So if a website is hosted on an Onion service, there's no way to take it down. A lot of good comes out of it, and of course a lot of bad comes out of it. Depends on who you talk to. But one of the most famous examples is, of course, like I said, Silk Road. But like I said, there's a lot of code that's also hosted on Onion services. So it's not just Silk Road and stuff.
Like the Secure Drops for Public.
Right, the Secure Drops they didn't talk about.
And my homepage.
Great. So this is going undergoing a lot of development. I'm not getting too much detail because this is a technical topic. But if you ever have to post something that, A, you don't want that it should be taken down by the government, or B, that you want to protect your own location anonymity of the server, this is how you do it. And there are ways to set up. If you just say Google set up hidden service, you'll find lots of tutorials on how to do that. But this is an advanced topic, so I'm not getting into that. Okay, any questions related to this? Yes?
Is it HTTPS?
So I won't say HTTPS because that will assume that it's running a web server, but anything that's running here, any connection to that is end-to-end encrypted by default. So if you say run a mail server, that would also be end-to-end encrypted. So anything that runs, the connection is encrypted end-to-end.
Do you have any contact with Let's Encrypt to have a valid SSL cert for the .onion addresses?
I think they're talking to them. Not me, but I think they're talking.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll give an example later. So second part of the talk is that Tor is just not Tor browser, which is like people just say Tor is Tor browser. There's many, many more things in Tor. First, of course, is like HTTPS everywhere. So this basically redirects you to the HTTPS site. Why do you need to do that? Because many websites have HTTPS set up, but they don't load it for some weird reason that I've never been able to understand. And the justifications given don't make sense in 2017. But they'll send you to the HTTP page, and what HTTPS everywhere does is that if it detects that HTTPS for that page exists, it will redirect you to the HTTPS version of that. Okay? Most websites, I hope they are using HTTPS. For websites which are but are not exposing HTTPS, this is a way to do it. This is developed with EFF, so it's EFF and Tor joint project. But this also ships as part of Tor browser. So if you're running Tor browser, you get this as part of it. So there's Tor on Android as well. So on Android smartphones, it's called TorBot, which is the little T-Tor, and RFox, which is Tor browser. So if you need to use Tor on Android, you would just install RBot. If you need a browser as well, you would install RFox. RBot has a very interesting VPN mode. So if you install RBot, enable VPN mode and start it. Any traffic that, so it's basically a VPN, right? So any traffic that originates on the Android phone that goes through Tor. So it's possible that any and all traffic on your phone, and if you have to send it through Tor, you would use RBot. So it's basically Tor on Android. Tails is a secure operating system made famous by Edward Snowden. If you haven't heard, before Edward Snowden, when he wanted to talk to Glenn Greenwald and Lord of WordPress, he used Tails. Tails is, among many other things, Tails runs Tor. It has a lot of security and privacy features, like if you can run it from a USB and it will leave no trace of its installation. It has a lot of privacy tools as well. It's not for everyone, but if you're looking for privacy, this is the best you could possibly get. There are many new operating systems as well. But Tails is the one that's closely tied to the ecosystem. So what happens if you have an application and you want to run it through Tor? Okay, and I'll give a demo here as well. How you do that is using something called Tor Socks. It's basically an ELF, like an ELF share library. So it preloads before anything else, and then it intercepts the libc function calls like, say, connect and get host by name. So if your application is trying to talk to the internet, Tor Socks intercepts that and reroutes it through Tor. So let's see how it works in a small example. Okay, so let's suppose this is my current IP address, okay? And now I want to run curl over Tor. Like any request that curl sends out should be done over Tor. Okay? Yeah, I was like starting to talk things. So I didn't want to get over that. And now you'll do. Okay, so now it says Tor mode activated. Every command will be torified for this shell. Torified, the word is torified means that you take a program and then anything it does over the internet, it goes to Tor. So that's called torification or torify. So now let's run curl again. And it gives you a different IP address. Okay. So this is the IP address of the exit node, the one that's fetching the page for you. Now anything you do on this shell, it goes over Tor. Yes.
Can you run it one more time? Did you change circuit?
Circuit by default changes after every 10 minutes. You could decrease that time as well, but again, that's an advanced topic.
If you have a long-run connection, the circuit that's will stay open though.
Yeah, but
okay.
Yeah, it refreshes after every 10 minutes.
For new connections.
Existing connections refresh as well. So if you have a circuit that you open 10 minutes, it will refresh after every 10 minutes.
Won't that break the long running session?
Yes.
Interesting.
You should check this if I'm wrong. If I'm wrong, tell me. Okay. This changes, so if you run out of 10 minutes, it probably give you a different IP address. Now, I'm of course going to show you how you can figure out the circuit.
Would you refresh all three or just the middle one?
Again, that's too much technical academy.
Because the answer would be no, it wouldn't break the session.
If you just
the only middle one that was being broken.
Yeah.
But it's also not to be, you're not supposed to really keep sockets open for 10 minutes. Like, it's meant for browsing, and you're not upgrading your operating system.
But I mean, if you're in a chat session, then you would, like...
Yeah.
Yeah.
But if you're using something like an this is mine, sorry.
Outside of the movies, I don't know what else would actually be running for 10 minutes. Or would be able to reconnect. Like, chat sessions can reconnect, basically.
Some websites actually log you out. They do fancy stuff with the IP and stuff. So if they see the IPs change midway, they just, like...
Yeah.
They would, like...
We don't have the answer. We'll check the FAQ
okay.
And come back to it.
Yeah. So that's how you would do it. Now the question can be, why not just take this and run Firefox, right? You wouldn't do that because that doesn't take care of the application layer concerns. So if you run Tor browser, it will give you always a user agent on Windows, right? There are many application level concerns, is what I'm trying to say. That those are not addressed by. Okay. So, this is good for like very small and basic stuff. But if you have a proper application like, say, Firefox or Thunderbird, which I'm going to talk about, you would need a specific add on. And you can't just say Torify Firefox because that doesn't work. Okay? Am I being clear? Sorry.
In effect, Firefox is a chatty application.
So applications leak out a lot of information, is what I'm trying to say. and those application layer concerns are not taken care of by this. So let's suppose your Firefox has a particular version number, right? If you connect to an exit node, the exit node can see that version number when it's trying to fetch a page for you. Okay? So this doing this doesn't take care of the application level concerns, for that's why you need Tor browser. And I'll talk about something else for Thunderbird as well and why you need something else for Thunderbird. Okay, so Ricochet is a chat client and it has a feature that I think probably no other client or very few have, is that it is metadata free. So in other chat networks like XMPP, if A is talking to B, the server knows that A is talking to B. Okay, so that's the metadata, right? So if you call someone, the phone company knows that you're calling them, that's metadata as well. With Ricochet, there is no metadata. I'm not going to give the technical technicality of how it works, but it runs hidden services or onion services. So there's no contact list compared to other networks. So let's suppose you're talking to someone over Facebook. That's a bad example because Facebook can read everything as well, right? But let's suppose that you're encrypting your communication and Facebook is unable to read what you're talking about. But they still know that you're talking to B. And for some people, rightfully so, this is a huge privacy leak. Because metadata tells a lot of information about you. I want to give a small example is that if you Google for some health-related issue, and then you call your doctor, right? Or you call a doctor and then you call all of your friends or relatives, for example, right? This may mean that something is up, okay? So suppose you have someone has a disease and that person calls up a particular health clinic, that itself reveals a lot of information about you, right? So Ricochet is the only client that it's impossible to find out who's talking to whom or what they're talking about, okay? Tor Messenger is what I work on with two of my teammates, Arlo and Nicola. So this is a chat client with native Tor and OTR support. OTR is off-the-record messaging. Has anyone heard about that? Yeah, so OTR is off-the-record messaging. It encrypts the contents of your texts, chat messages, so it's impossible for anyone to figure it out. The difference between this and this is that this is for existing social networks, like Twitter, Facebook, Google Talk, IRC, XMPP. Okay, so the difference, if you want to talk about the very high level difference, the difference is that using this, you have to get the other person also to use Ricochet, okay? With this, the difference is that if you have a friend, say, on Facebook, but you want to talk to them, but don't want Facebook knowing what you're talking about, you would use Tor Messenger. And this works for IRC, this works for XMPP as well. Have you heard of Pigeon? So with Pigeon, the difference is that you have to manually configure Tor. Pigeon is, I would not say Pigeon is a very good software. The reason is that it has a lot of vulnerabilities. With this is that everything is like, so with Pigeon you have to configure Tor, but with Tor Messenger, everything is configured automatically for you. So you would just run Tor Messenger, like set up Tor and not do all the other stuff. Okay. Now again, let me give the example of Thunderbird. Thunderbird is another ThorBuddy is another application I maintain. So in ThorBuddy, this is basically for your email. Like Firefox is for browsing, this is for email. So what this basically does is it takes Thunderbird and does a lot of security enhancements to it. So like it sets up more security faults, it tries to like put out the leaks. Now the question comes, why couldn't we just run Tor stocks and then say Thunderbird? Is because of this reason, that even if you do something like that, you're still leaking out a lot of information. Like if you send out an email in Thunderbird, it puts the user agent in the email header, so anyone receiving the email can tell which email client you're using. Most clients do that, okay? But if you use ThorBuddy, for example, ThorBuddy scrubs all that information. So the person you're sending the email, they will have no idea what client you're using. And this is a security concern as well, because if they can find out what client they're using, they can like do targeted attacks and stuff, right? So basically it does a lot of security enhancements. Yeah.
And does that project support having IMAP and SMTP servers on the .onion?
Right, it does, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm not getting into too much detail for today, but I hope to stick around for GTLX, like something we can talk about later in the coming days and stuff. So talking about transports is, a lot of countries block Tor, and the easiest way to do that, of course, is that they just block access to Tor project.org. Okay. But then people use mirrors, and there are other things as well. But some countries go a step further, and they start doing deep packet inspection on Tor traffic. So they sniff the connections to try to find out if a user is using Tor, using deep packet inspection, DPI, and if they find that out, they try to block those connections. This was the thing that I showed in the start. So if you would use Tor in a country where Tor is blocked, normal connection doesn't work, and you have to use something called a public plugin for transport. So what it basically does is it obfuscates your Tor traffic. So it changes your Tor traffic to make it appear innocent and to appear like other traffic. So even if a sensor is doing deep packet inspection on the traffic, they wouldn't be able to figure.
Do you have any feedback about how well this works in China?
On off, we keep on hearing something works, something doesn't, but the last thing I heard was that it's working. Yeah. Keeps on changing.
Okay.
And then they keep on updating it. So it's an arms race that keeps on coming.
Arms race.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right. I'll probably talk about it later. So this gives us, so for example, Iran does a lot of debug inspection. And at one point, they were just like dropping all SSL connections because they failed to block Tor. So this has stopped everything SSL. But they couldn't do it for a long time because once you start dropping SSL connections, the economy also suffers because the banking and everything runs on SSL.
Sure.
So they have to bring it back up. There are many countries doing it. This is just one example. So if this is happening, then you need to use backup and transport. Again, you don't need to do anything. You just need to, when you start Tor browser, it will give you an option to choose this, and you choose that, and then get started on it for you. Okay. So metrics is where you find out everything about the network. How many users are there? What are the top countries they're connecting from? What's the total bandwidth available in the network? Stuff like that. Of course, this is all done in a way that we don't put, like, we don't de-anonymize users. There's a lot of research that's gone into this. So it's not as if we're keeping logs or something. No, we're not. Even if they are, they're very sanitized logs. Okay. This graph, for example, I just like, you can just click a button and from this website and generate the graph for you. So this basically shows the number of directly connecting users. So right now, hovers would be like above 2 million, if you can see that. Okay. You could do other stuff as well, like where are the top 10 countries people are connecting from, and Canada is one of them. So, like I told you in the start, if you not in a country where it's censored, there are still people going to Tor every day. Stem is a Python controller for Tor. When we mean, this is a, like one of the advanced topics, but I want to touch base on that. A controller is something that allows you to control the Tor process. So let's suppose you have installed Tor on your system and you want to see what all circuits have been created, right? How do you see that? So you need to talk to the Tor process. And how you do that is using a controller. Stem is one of those controllers, and I have an example, like a small demo to show how it works. Okay, so I have a Tor connection running, and this should not be pseudo, but it is. So, what this basically did is that it connected to the Tor process that's running on my system, and it fetched all the circuits that it, like my client has created right now. So right now I have a total of 28 circuits. So Tor creates multiple circuits for a single TCP connection. So all these are multiplexed. So you can see this is the, these are the names of the relays, and these are the IP addresses. So you can control the Tor process, and how you do that is using a controller like this, for example. Now, just to be clear, this is not my script. This is Damien's script, who's the author. So this script basically, like I'm not expecting to get into too much detail, but basically if you want to control the Tor process, you could do that using a Tor controller. And one of the Tor controllers is called STEM. That's what I'm going to show you. So you see, right now, 28 circuits. Next is a CLI-based monitor. So people who run Tor relays, they want to see interesting statistics on like how many terabytes of traffic or gigabytes of traffic they're transferring every month. So one of the ways they do that is using NICs. So it's basically something you run on a versus interface. So you can basically like SSH into a remote server and run this. And it will tell you, so let's suppose you're running a relay and you want to find out how many gigabytes of traffic you have transferred in a month. You would use NICs, that's what relay operators use. THTorCloud is another Python controller. It's for like asynchronous and Twisted based event-driven programming. So if you've heard of Twisted, if you've used Twisted or you want to do event-based programming and you need a controller, you would use THTorCloud. It's like STEM, but it does all the other stuff as well. Yeah.
What would you use that for? Just out of curiosity.
A lot of projects use that. Like, so if you have to do event-based programming, like anything that, like, say, suppose something depends on user input and you don't want to, like you know, like, to how Twisted works.
Yeah, I do.
Like, so if you visit the website, there are many use cases.
Okay.
I have to explain, like, a lot of stuff into that, but it has a lot of use cases on the website. Okay. So you would use this when you want to do, have an asynchronous controller, but for otherwise you would use STEM. UNI is a very interesting project, and not many people have heard about it, but what UNI does is basically it measures internet censorship around the world. So they have something called an UNI probe, and people all over the world run UNI probes on their phones or laptops. And what UNI probe does is that it has a list of websites that are theoretically banned. So what it tries to do is that it tries to fetch those websites and see if they're still banned, and in which regions they are banned or censored, for example. And then it has this map where it shows you in which countries internet censorship is taking place. So there's no block websites for Canada. And of course this data keeps on changing. Okay, that's fine. Probably. So Italy is blocking foreign websites. So if you find out what country is blocking which websites, you do that using UNI. It's updated, and you can run many probes, so they have the latest information. Yeah.
So, in this particular case, the purpose of Tor is for getting the information back?
No, it's one of Tor's sub-projects. I wouldn't say getting the information back, but it's used for other things, but not getting the information back. But it's one of Tor's sub-projects, is one of the main things while talking about it.
Sorry, let me specify that. The UNI project uses Tor for what purpose? My question is it using Tor to access these sites, which doesn't make sense for gauging whether it's blocked or not, or it's using it to guarantee that it can get the information out of a blocked network to a central point to observe?
I think getting it back is one of the things, but I am not exactly sure what the other main things are.
If you can answer that.
Yeah, I think getting it back is one of the things, but I think the main thing is that it's a Tor project, sub-project. Most of these people were Tor developers, and then they started this project because there was no other way to measure with block websites. Researchers use it for this reason that there's nothing there right now. Okay, so that's what UNI is.
You're not able to answer this question, but do you know how many tell you that? Like, if I'm in Canada, how many Canadian websites are blocked?
Just because I'm not the right person probably, but I'll try to answer this, that okay. They have a list of websites.
Yeah.
I think it's far, it's on a per country basis.
Okay.
And people say that this list should be updated, they update it. And then the pro price to fetch that page.
Okay.
So that's how it measures if censorship is still on. And it also does extra stuff, like it checks if the data is being tampered or not.
The reason I'm asking is that there are countries in the world where basically activists have websites that are blocked internally, you
right.
can see them externally.
Right, right. And that's why you run a probe from the country you are importing data from. So if you're in country X and you want to import the data for that country, you would actually go there and run it, or you would get a CWPS in that country, for example.
Okay.
Yeah. So you volunteers run it, so you run an Uniprobe. So if I go to the country and then I run Uniprobe on the connection, which is a bit risky, of course, because if you're trying to access all these websites, some of them are like political websites as well.
Yeah.
You can get in trouble in many countries. In some countries, you can actually get in trouble for opening websites or like do that. So, like, I mean, not get in trouble, but your ISP would probably figure that out that you're trying to fetch that page. Yeah.
So, are there countries where there's decidedly not Tor nodes?
North Korea.
Okay, yeah. China seems to do a fair bit of censorship of sites.
Yeah.
Is it unsafe to have a Tor node in China? Probably, maybe, I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I don't think I should name places. I don't know if you can do all that. But I've seen exits in places that I want to trust my exit to be. Because of the prevailing government censorship and stuff. And I had a question mark on why this is there, but I haven't talked too much about it, to be honest. Mostly I exit in North America and Europe, for example. That's where the most of the regions are, so I haven't thought much about it. Yeah.
You kind of follow on to that question. Legal liability for people operating exit nodes.
That's a little hotter.
So I guess a lot of private individuals might be wary of posting exit nodes.
That's true.
Want to have it back in those
days. You should. Great question. I should have thought about this. Don't run an exit node if you don't know what you're doing. Luckily, we are in Canada, and I doubt you would get into trouble. But there are places you would get trouble. People are getting a lot of trouble because the traffic is exiting from your node. So basically, you are responsible for the traffic in a way. Okay. People have gotten in trouble for running Tor nodes. This is a very hot topic. So on the Tor blog, if you search running an exit relay, the first thing they tell you is that don't do this if you don't know what you're doing.
Because I know, like 10 years ago, like when Wi-Fi was really getting prevalent, as a courtesy, I used to run like open. You know, like in the very early days, you'd open up your connection, allow people, you know, to like check
your
email or whatever.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But then sometimes you go away and come back and it's like 25 gigs
of
traffic for a weekend.
Right.
You know,
right.
So I can do more than check your email.
Right.
And then eventually, it's kind of a disincentive to do that anymore. And now everybody locks their internet.
In certain countries, wiretapping is forbidden very strictly. So part of the problem is that I mean, I would never run a relay, an exit relay, because I'm afraid of what may happen.
Sure.
I've run relays, entry relays, and middle relays. So I grew up in India, and I have people here who say they want to run an exit relay. I'm like, do not do this, because you'll go to jail if you do that. But people who do run it, they usually, so like people in universities run it, they have a very strong backing. Legal backing as well, so they are able to explain to the state police that this is the difference between traffic originating from the machine and this is the difference between traffic from Tor.
And have you found like a receptive audience in universities, like say Ryerson or that, you approach them and they say, well, this is something we'd like to do or not to do? Or?
This US and Europe right now. So I went Waterloo, and Waterloo runs many exits, like people who run exits in Waterloo. And you actually, there's a way to look it up, how to run an exit, like where exits are being run right now. So one of the fastest exits right now is run in Waterloo. And many people are running meter wheelers and accreditors. But I say this as someone who's been with Thorbit for 5 years. I am very hesitant to run an exit because I don't think I can handle what happens if police knocks at the door. I'm not prepared to do that.
So if you wanted to help the project in some way, you might not run. Can you designate your relay to be the middle?
You can.
Okay.
So you can specifically say that this relay should not be the exit. Okay. It's just one line in the configuration file.
Okay.
Yeah. So you can choose. Sorry.
Why is Korea, North Korea, I mean, quite innocent, nothing happening there?
I think they have no reports from there. Just to be clear, I don't know much about this question.
It's very strange, right?
Because they have no information at all.
Yeah. I mean, someone has to be North Korea to run the relay, and to run the probe, and I don't know if people are brave enough to do that. I hope they're not.
Nobody is trying to actually, because this project wouldn't go hand in hand.
Right. This, I mean, that fits in our work.
Yeah. So this project wouldn't be something either.
Thank you.
That's an important detail to remember. The traffic isn't going through the Tor network. This is, we want to know what's being banned.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Someone has to be there and using their regular unfiltered internet to do the probes so that you get the best report from them. I'm sorry if I'm not being very helpful on me. I have like very little information about the project other than that it exists and they do a lot of good work, but that's all I know. Right?
I was going to ask a complicated question. Do they check to make sure that the website hasn't been defaced by the country?
Just to be clear, they say they do. So it's somewhere around here. They say they do this, they check for this stuff, but I don't know how it works or how they do it. I mean, this is a very, very complicated project. Sounds very easy, but there's a lot of tech going on underneath. They do a lot of stuff. It's not just not measuring censorship. They do stuff like checking for tampering also. So if your connection is being tampered and stuff, so they check as well.
So just to tailor questions going forward, you're just covering what's available and you don't necessarily know the details of
right.
all these projects.
If I don't know about a project, I'll tell you I don't know. I don't need something I don't know. Okay? Other projects, I can tell if you have questions, we'll talk to it at the end. But Uni, not the right person to ask. Okay?
In case you have other slides, okay?
Yeah. SecureDrop is probably my favorite project that's come out of Tor because it has the potential to make like real world impact. So SecureDrop is run by US organizations. It's easy to run it. And if you are a whistleblower, you visit the Onion address that's running SecureDrop to submit documents, to submit tips, to leak something, okay? The benefit is that theoretically, it's not possible for the people running SecureDrop to find out who you are, like where you are pulling documents from. Of course, you have to take care of other operational security and stuff. Like you say, if you're leaking a document and it has your name on it, of course, SecureDrop doesn't do anything. Okay? But what it helps you with is that if you're leaking documents and you know what you're doing and you're using SecureDrop, they don't know who you are, you don't know where they are. Like, not that that matters, but you don't know where the server is. Okay? And it's difficult to find out who this like person, who the whistleblower was. This has been run by a lot of news organizations, CDC, Globe and Mail, I think I told you. If you just go to the website, they have a list of the organizations on SecureDrop. Very interesting, and some, like when people say onion services are used for bad things, I give them this example that this is a good thing and why we should care about this stuff. Okay.
Just go researching from your office desktop.
Right. So if you're planning to leak something, get a new computer. Go to the shop, get it, don't take credit card. Get that computer, run tails, go to a coffee shop, then do it from there.
One cool thing that I really like about SecureDrop is they have like really good documentation.
Right.
Like it's not, it's meant for someone who has never like done it, that kind of thing before.
Right.
Yeah.
So if you have any documents and want to stop, there you go.
Print them at the library.
Ever print the micro dots.
Yeah. That's why I gave the example that if you would put your name on it and SecureDrop, of course, that helps you. So like I said, many countries log parproject.par, and Tim Hortons is not a country, but an example I could come up with that logs parproject.par. So if you're on the Tim Hortons Wi-Fi and you try to go to Tor project, they don't, they didn't do it. Okay. So of course, the other way you can do some like access the website is using mirrors. And if you just search Tor mirrors, there are like thousands of mirrors, so you can go to the mirror instead of going to Tor project. I know countries where Tor is project.org is blocked. I know people who work for software companies where Tor project.org is blocked. I have told you about coffee shops, and the list goes on. Okay, so that's the easiest way to block access, because if you...
Sorry, are ISPs in Canada that also actually specifically block Tor.project.org?
Oh, are there?
Yes. I'm not going to say which one.
That's okay.
There are.
That's surprising. So what happens if website is blocked? So suppose you're telling someone to use Tor and they tell you, oh, the website is blocked, what am I supposed to do now? Number one, you can tell them to find a mirror, or you can give them the address of a mirror. And the second is that we run an email service called gettor@torproject.org. So if you type in Windows and send it to this address, it will send you a list of websites which have hosted the Tor project bundles. So you would download it from them instead. And the websites, I think, currently are, I used to actually maintain this project, but someone else does it. So when I wrote the code, we were doing drive.google.com, dropbox.com at that time, because the assumption was that most countries hopefully do not block Google, but that is not true, because there are many companies that do block Google.
Right.
So the second thing we had was Dropbox, and most countries were not blocking Dropbox, but then I was told that China is blocking Dropbox as well. Okay. Again, not 100%. It's not a, like 100% solution, but works for most people. Another thing where this is very useful is that I have a friend who was a journalist, and I taught her how to use Tor, and she said, I don't want to visit torproject.org from my news organization. I said, okay, fine. So why? Because if you do visit torproject.org, you make a DNS request, and if they're logging your DNS requests, they know that you visit the torproject.org, right? So what you do is, in that case, you use gettor. And there's gettor, so this is basically a bot, so it's an automated system for email, XMPP, and Twitter. So on Twitter, it's @get_tor. So if you send a DM to it, it will send you back the bundles. There are many problems with that service. I don't want to get into them. Maybe at a later time. This is not perfect. It has a lot of problems. When we wrote the code, it had so many problems that I was upset, personally, that I'm providing a service which is not good. But it works for now, is what I have to say. Okay. If you want to get involved, this is the URL. I am happy to help with any questions you might have. My email address is there. This is my fingerprint. I will be there in subsequent meetings as well, in case you want to talk about Tor. I generally talk like this. This is what I like doing. I like digital security and privacy is my area. I'm not an expert by any means, but I've been doing this for a long time. So I'm happy to have a healthy discussion on this topic in general. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
That's great.